Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Backyard Parables, Lessons on Gardening and Life. Written and read by Margaret Roach. For Marco Polo Stufano, who, I suspect against his better instincts, made room for me so I could grow. Epigraph. What we need is here. Geese appear high over us, pass, and the sky closes. Abandon, as in love or sleep, holds them to their way, clear in the ancient faith. What we need is here. And we pray, not for new earth or heaven, but to be quiet in heart and in eye, clear. What we need is here. Wendell Berry. For myself, I am grateful to nature, not so much when I see her on the side that is open to the world as when I am permitted to enter her shrine. Then one may seek to know of what stuff the universe is made, who is its author or guardian, what is the nature of God. Life would have been a useless gift were I not admitted to the study of such themes. Seneca, 4 BC to AD 65, from Natural Questions, Book 1.
Preface.
Once upon a time, a faithless 25-year-old got down on her knees and fashioned her first garden. It was a sorry thing, but also a matter of great pride, this perennial checkerboard imprinted on a sloping bit of ground outside her family's kitchen door. As if pricking through a pre-printed canvas pattern of counted cross-stitch, she populated the tiny strip of inadequately cultivated soil with an equal number of two kinds of perennials. Half were low-growing, succulent rosettes called semper vivum, or hens and chicks, house leeks, or live forever, since as she tucked these first roots in, she unwittingly entered a world where all the characters masquerade behind multiple nicknames, and where art and science collide so that there's no straight answer to anything, which, miraculously, somehow makes everything perfectly clear. The others were Niphophia, a.k.a. red-hot pokers, torch lilies, or tritomas, a tall thing with vaguely obscene wand-like flowers striped in hot sunset shades. She did not leave proper space between, nor note the light conditions either plant required, but for that moment there was peace on earth and trust in her heart. In the practice of blind devotion to living things called gardening, that is where I got started. Assuming a posture of supplication and gritting out an alternating arrangement of plants that should never be combined. But what did I know? Just one thing, really. I knew that the postage stamp-sized color photos on their plastic nursery labels had made lust rise up in me. Over all the other choices at the garden center where I had innocently wandered that morning, seeking a distraction from things at home, I wanted these beauties for myself. This is how it begins. With the deadly sin of lust. Then you kneel a lot, and when you finally get up again, you're not meek or humble quite yet, but filled with the germ of another transgression, that of pride, which is said to be the worst of all and often the root of the others. Like the knees of your trousers, you will never quite recover. Thinking back, I wonder, what was I greedily praying for as I knelt that very first day? Was it for the thousands of hapless perennial seeds, the entire contents of each of many packets whose cunning cover photos had also won my heart during that same nursery shopping trip? I had planted them in too close quarters, set them in a porch where they'd be guaranteed too little light, and overwatered for good measure. As I poured instead of pinched them into place, like a kid happily suffocating cookies with sprinkles or a card for mom with glitter, I was imagining riot of color, meadow-sized beds that never stopped blooming. I don't think I knew enough to know what trouble the seeds and I were in. No, I had probably come to these first two naive, concurrent experiments of mad science, seeking something with at least a little hope attached. Inside the house, just beyond that kitchen doorway and the ad hoc propagation porch, these were not sunny days, but ones where a loved one struggled with illness and would not get well. I flailed in various ways as I tried to find the answer to why and sought any shred of optimism, the powerful potion of possibility, or, better yet, belief. I got a garden such as the wretched patch was, which in itself can feed the soul and even the body, but I also got occupational therapy, then eventually faith in the bargain, faith cultivated by a sequence of life lessons that all the digging and weeding and watering that followed brought to the surface. Even now, 30 years in, new ones are turned up, and my collection of backyard parables, deceptively simple, instructive stories from a life spent digging ever deeper, grows. Preposterous as it seems, since we are not exactly quoting catechism but merely talking about lily beetle larvae, revolting, or what deer won't eat, nothing, or how to keep a 15-foot viburnum in a spot that can only accommodate six, you do the math, then cut it down. The parables illuminate and help me puzzle out every corner of my existence, providing a lens sharper and brighter than the default one I came with. I believe in parables, Barbara Kingsolver wrote in Small Wonder. I navigate life using stories where I find them, and I hold tight to the ones that tell me new kinds of truth. Me too. Me too. What is a parable? Like a thorn bush brandished by the hand of a drunkard is a parable in the mouth of a fool. Proverbs 26:9. Trust your gut if you wish to garden or write books. Then, before anyone notices your rough edges or other shortcomings, do some serious homework. I came to the start of my work on the backyard parables semi-ignorant of what a parable is, even though I was aware all along that the word, which I now know derives from the Greek parabole for juxtaposition or comparison, would be the main event of the book's title. I had, in fact, suggested the title myself, but when I delivered the proposal with the backyard parables typed confidently across the top, I thought, as I suspect others may, that all parables were in the New Testament, stories a man named Jesus told to his disciples and other followers in attempts to articulate aspects of life and God. I vaguely recalled from my brief, none-too-rigorous religious instruction that they read like extended analogies or metaphors, meant to shed light on something other than the facts of their actual plot. Indeed, depending on which expert's count you adhere to, there are between 37 and 65 parables in the Gospels, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke specifically. No religion corners the market, though, and the ones in the New Testament were not the first nor the last. There are parables and parable-like sayings in virtually every cultural tradition and religion throughout history. In Hinduism and in Buddhism, as well as from philosophers of the Confucian tradition and from the ancient Greeks such as Socrates and Aristotle. For all their often acrimonious differences, the root traditions and most holy books of Islam, the Quran contains 40 parables, Christianity and Judaism agree on at least two things: that parables are an effective way of teaching, and that it is hard to find a more bountiful source of compelling script material than the examples set by the natural world and mankind's interactions with it. There are budding or barren trees and vines, some that bend in the wind and some that break, all manner of seeds sown on all manner of ground, farm fields filled with weeds or rich with hidden treasure, harvests reaped and those lost to flood and drought and all extremes of dramatic, heaven-sent conditions. Nature is no fool, nor does it suffer them. From its mouth come utterances that we should not disregard because it sets the best examples of life's rhythm. It has busy times and down times. It surges and it rests. Nature also utters a constant invocation to look past the in-your-face stuff of life to where the real action is. So do parables. Parables are not fables, that is, there are no fantastical happenings such as talking animals to entertain. Who needs such invention when you have the distinct character of each season and its displays of the almighty elements, when you have the natural world and the man-made contrivance within it that we call a garden, all ripe with ahas? There is one definition of parable that I like best, from contemporary New Testament scholar Klein R. Snodgrass. Parables, he says, are stories with intent. And that phrase became the title of his massive work on the subject, published in 2008. They are provocative, like the garden is for me. To my ear and heart, the garden is a perennial Dharma talk, a meditation, a reminder to reflect. It teaches us to live with intimacy and attention and asks that we feel the pulse of more than just our own interior life force, instead seeing ourselves as part of a vast, complex organism and story. As Emerson wrote in Nature, every natural process is a version of a moral sentence. The garden and its backdrop of nature are good, maybe the best places to learn something beyond how many clutches a robin can lay each spring, up to three, or how deep to plant a herbaceous peony if you want it to bloom, not just survive, a mere inch or so. And by the way, if you're south of Birmingham, Alabama, don't bother planting them at all, since as with lilacs, a real winter chill period is required. Let it go. I'll cover some such tactical dirty secrets in these pages in a series of practical sidebars, but I do so in the hopes that the facts of horticulture and of botanical science will serve as catalysts to deeper engagement. The tips are my bribe, but not the main ingredient. They're like the literal surface level of a parable, but by no means the whole story. Not long ago, I was speaking to a garden club and, as always, mentioned my connection to the garden, our relationship, the gardens and mine, and how it has a powerful spiritual quality. Afterward, over china pots of tea and plates of homemade cookies in the historic church's basement, a woman with nearly 50 years of horticultural experience came up to me. "I never thought about it before listening to how you spoke about your place today," she said, whispering almost conspiratorially, as if we were back upstairs in the church's nave. "But now I do think I'm intimate with my garden, too." We Westerners call gardening a hobby, but how can hobby do descriptive justice to the way garden and gardener become one, interlocking pieces of the same puzzle that's bigger than the sum of its parts? I often wonder who's tending whom, really, but never have to wonder who's actually in charge. It's not me. It is, you see, though many people find the idea amusing, the garden that makes the gardener, said the late Alan Chadwick, 1909 to 1980, founder of the French Biodynamic School of Horticulture, an early inspiration in my love of growing things and of my loathing of chemicals. Are it and I some equation of cause and effect, or simply not two, or Advaita, as the concept is expressed in Hinduism? Yes, that's more it, not two. Does bowling or bridge or knitting invite this depth of communion, or explain so many bigger than us mysteries, or bring us into full awareness and contemplation of the cycles of life on earth? From the garden, I have had to face my powerlessness and the limits of exerting control. I have embraced losses as opportunity, put aside pride and asked for help, faced facts and started over. My upright stance and larger brain notwithstanding, I have come to see myself as a cog in the food chain, for truly are we any more or less? Realizing that has been the biggest payoff, the prize-winning pumpkin at the county fair. If I am an evangelist for anything, it is for harvesting the something more in every season spent sowing, tilling, weeding, and hopefully reaping. Gardening is not outdoor decorating. Do tackle the philosophical equivalent of double digging every time you step outside. Please do. Frankly, this other level is the best part, and it's also where I derive my basic approach to gardening, a style I call horticultural how-to and woo-woo. Even the worst weather can't trash the something more. In fact, adversity can foster a bumper crop of it. I have said many times since I began writing about the subject 25 years ago that gardening is my spiritual practice, a moving meditation not unlike the motions of a well-practiced vinyasa in yoga. It's as if gardeners, provided we pay attention, have an invitation to receive the secret from the source. Like those disciples of diverse masters who were privy early to the lessons that made their way into all the holy books full of parables, dare I say gardeners are in a position to really start to see the light? Saved by the garden. I can state with conviction, and did in "And I Shall Have Some Peace There," that my garden saved me. It would not be an overstatement to claim that it has all the answers, but most simply put, gardening lifts the spirits. Even the esteemed mathematician and philosopher Bertrand Russell was struck by that fact. "I've made an odd discovery," he wrote. Every time I talk to a savant, I feel quite sure that happiness is no longer a possibility. Yet when I talk with my gardener, I'm convinced of the opposite. I'd venture to say it's because his gardener, any gardener, feels part of something. Perhaps for the first time, he finds true connection, clear purpose, and even the sweet, succulent hope of a potential homegrown harvest, the most local form of locavorism. So many beginner gardeners give up after a nonstop color English herbaceous border dream or wildflower meadow fantasy fails to materialize out of that first tricky seed packet, as it did with mine. Feeling gypped, as if it were a Duncan Hines mix, but the cake just didn't rise, they are gone. I am grateful that I am not among them, despite my embarrassing start with the grid of Niphophia and Semper Vivum, and that what I have never dropped since I found it is my long-handled shovel, a seeming divining rod for life's impalpable jackpots. If you keep at it for more than four seasons, until the patterns inevitably repeat themselves, that should give you the first big hint. This has been going on like this before you ever stepped into the circle, and will do so after you leave. Perhaps you'll get lucky and glimpse the elemental cycle playing itself out outside, and recognize that it's not that different from the measurements of our own human lives. That's why I have always counted six seasons, not just those official four, in my anthropomorphic gardening calendar of sorts. In my head, at least, the year goes like this. It starts with the season of conception in January, February, when you order seeds, conceive of the garden on paper, and otherwise make plans. Next is the season of birth in March, April, as the first shoots of snowdrops or hellebores push through, offering signs of life again and new beginning. Youth comes next in May, June, when everything grows so fast. It's the Jack and the Beanstalk high energy time as the days get longer and the kids outgrow the space you allotted them, the way you once outgrew your sneakers and winter boots, along with every other article of clothing, before each new school year. In July, August, it's the season of adulthood, when full potential is reached. In my temperate climate, most things are at the peak of growth before this next tricky stage comes on. Senescence, in biology, the process of deterioration that comes with age of a cell or larger organism, takes hold here in September, October, or at the current time in my own life. It's the start of the downhill slope, the winding down, a wise, rich, and also unsettling moment of letting go in our lives and backyards as we witness and hopefully start to embrace the inevitable. The season of death and afterlife arrives in November, December, where, here in the north at least, parts of the garden go into hiding. But life will rise again, dust to dust, from the compost heap, where you just buried the remains of the latest casualties. Whatever our diverse and sometimes discordant belief systems, all gardeners can agree that there is reincarnation in the compost pile, no? It was this six-phase structure that organized the first garden book I wrote, A Way to Garden, the one I named my garden website for almost a decade later, in 2008, and I still find it very helpful and comforting, frankly, to think that way. But lately, in the years since I moved from a city career and weekend country life to full-time rural reality, I have come to feel quite a lot smaller than ever in the face of things, more speck than spectacular. This time, therefore, I will let the other side of the equation, not my comparatively measly humanness, but nature and specifically the elements, inspire the section titles. Isn't gardening and all of life simply a matter of repeatedly confronting the elemental? The Backyard Parables, then, has just four chapters, beginning as the calendar year does where I live, in a time dominated by water, albeit in its wintertime frozen state, which puts the garden out of reach and does its best to disrupt activities as simple as opening the back door across its frost-heaved threshold. Earth is chapter two, as an emerging spring welcomes me back into reassuring contact with the soil. Summer is the time of fire, of intense sunshine. Fiat lux, let light be made. And hot, often dry days, the hardest season to stare down. The wind, the actual element air at its most insistent, when it is almost visible and feels like a solid, comes next, blowing in the stiffest change of the year each autumn and, on its heels, another frozen time. And so it goes. I'm informed by the seasons, however we name them, and by how each element behaves in turn to give each its distinct character. I'm also regularly brought to awareness by other gardeners, such as my late Grandma Marion, the first gardener I knew, my delightfully extant, outspoken sister Marion, who coined the phrase, "I've got an urgent gardening question," as a hook left on my answering machine to start us speaking again years ago after a terrible rift during our mother's decline to early onset Alzheimer's when we were in our early 20s. And my longtime inspiration, Marco Polo Stufano. "I garden from a compulsion to make things beautiful," he says, but kindly tolerates my woo-woo talk. He and I met more than 20 years ago, shortly after each of us had lost someone close to us to illness. I like to think we made a space for each other the way that gardeners do for new plants after a storm or a wicked season, when beloved things are felled. Hurt and in mourning, yes, but also knowing that if those losses hadn't been suffered, we might never have had an opening for this new creature in our lives. Marco, the founding director of horticulture for Wave Hill in New York City, one of the nation's most loved gardens, was my literal silver lining to such sadness, a silver-haired and bearded wise man who also has a particular inclination towards silver-leaved plants. And then there is the case of my other dearest friend, Erica, not a gardener exactly, and sadly lacking the M-A-R prefix to her name that the aforementioned three share with me, but nonetheless a lover of flowers, to whom I gave paper whites one year as part of her holiday gift. I had the best intentions, I swear that I did. "Why don't I have flowers yet?" Erica's phone call started, a little ashamed and also somewhat panicky, but with just the touch of gift horse in the mouth undertones. "Why do I have all this white spaghetti growing up out of the soil?" Oh dear, and then some. I guess I forgot to tell her which end was up. Maybe that's the biggest lesson of all. Which end is really up will show itself to you if you garden long enough. Would that we were all innately as smart as bulbs and seeds planted other than upright, who, thanks to gravitropism, a response to gravity causing stems to grow up and roots down, will in time right themselves, unless stuck in a tiny pot in Erica's apartment where all bets are off. The more we engage with growing things, our consciousness shifts too. We can learn to have a bright take on bad weather, or at least within reason, the boundaries of which the ailing planet seems to regularly go beyond these days. We learn the senselessness of grasping as if anything living can be permanent, even if it is just the right, rare, slow-growing tree that you set in the perfect spot so many years ago, where it became the garden's focal point, the tree that simply didn't leaf out this year but stands as a defiant skeleton because there is no budget quite yet to have it taken down. That will show you for relying so heavily on me, Missy. Our senses sharpen to the point where on a breezy fall day we can differentiate whether the tree above us is an oak or a maple just by listening, eyes closed, or detect a mourning dove taking flight anytime, or know that the rufous-sided towhee's just over there because the distinctive scratching in the leaf litter sounds different from a chipmunk's. Really, no peeking. There is no greater practice for cultivating sensuality than shutting your eyes and smelling long-needed rain hit soil and plants that couldn't wait much longer, or standing silently in a bed as noisy bumblebees cover their velvety selves in taxicab-colored pollen by darting hungrily in and out of every last flower in the joint. Oh, to be able to touch their cherubic forms without recrimination. Some longings, many longings, will never be fulfilled. If all our desires were sated, what would the fun or motivation be? Through gardening, we learn that even some of those who are not like us turn out to be, when you overhear them at the post office telling the postmaster, who prides himself on his tomatoes, how their dahlias are doing, not talking about the politics you might so heatedly disagree on. And then, as if they heard your unspoken disbelief that you have anything in common and want to erase that doubt, they turn to ask you if you could use some tubers this fall, once they're dug and cured. And at almost the same instant, another person pulling mail from his box across the little lobby asks if you need help getting that damn rabbit he keeps seeing scurry under your fence lately. Happy to pop it for you, Margaret. Just say so. Brethren all. Though the pursuit of horticulture is all about control, asking nature and particularly plants to submit to cultivation at our hands, it's also where everything is totally out of control. Things die when they feel like it, making big holes. Others self-sow where you didn't place them, outlining and then coloring in pictures prettier than the ones you intended, but for which you can take credit if you desire, maybe using words like serendipity or happy accident with false modesty and perhaps a sense of relief that at least something looks really good. It's there in risking surrender to the possibility of what on a scorecard might read as a losing round some years, and there will be plenty, that the real growth we're all after begins. Why this of all the years? While helping a prominent charity evaluate gardens that are applying for preservation advice or funds, Marco came back from one such site visit with his highest form of praise. "It was wonderful, you know, right on that fuzzy edge where it's all about to fall apart and be lost forever. I remember that edge with fondness. I glimpsed it here in a few corners of the place not long ago, and then it and those parts of the garden got away from me, as gardens have a particularly exasperating compulsion to do. It is a bit in that good news, bad news, sweet and sour way that I was contracted to write a garden book at this particular moment in my life and the life of my garden. The assignment, one I'd hoped for because there is nothing I like to write about more, is rife with irony. Or perhaps it's just that my garden has my number and is quite the prankster, acting out and acting badly because it knows I'll always be there, even if it takes me for granted, as I sometimes do it. Like an old married couple, the garden and I have been together a very long time, and we are both showing our age, facts that make for a different sort of story than the one of blind exuberance of our rising sap phase 25 years ago, or even the one I wrote about in my first garden book, A Way to Garden, in 1998. As with any relationship, it was much easier before it got so big and involved. In this case, familiarity has bred not contempt exactly, but chores, endless chores. I know we are going to have to make some serious adjustments if we are going to last the rest of the way through till death us do part phase. For every time you buy a plant and bring it home, that's the implied commitment, no? Till death. We are intimates, but also antagonists at times, and truthfully, I have on many days lately come to doubt that I know how to do this any longer. Accepting an assignment to write about the relationship has only heightened the crisis of confidence that perhaps I am a fraud or at least a burned-out case who just doesn't have what it takes. Nothing like being surrounded by your subject matter 24/7, 365, and for every weed pulled or swath of turf mowed to be undertaken with, "How does this fit into the book?" on your mind. Despite any such reservations, I am grateful that the overriding emotion is that of a consuming devotion. I know we could not live without each other, for better or for worse. A garden without a gardener is a jungle waiting to happen, another vintage Margaretism, and a gardener without a plot is soon in tatters too. But where did that person disappear to who toiled happily until she could not even climb the stairs at night, blithely wearing her yellow jacket bites and berberis and rosa scratches as if they were merit badges? The one who was happy to sleep on the couch, a sofa covered in drop cloths, actually, since the house was gutted at the time, with endless DIY works in progress inside and out, and start all over again at dawn. Oh, yes, of course, she's outside mowing. Mowing, with its instant visible signs of progress, is the way I productively procrastinate these days about tackling the jobs that a middle-aged garden requires. Not just the brutal decisions about what to do with misshapen shrubs now too closely planted after decades, or masses of bulbs that no longer bloom because they are likewise overcrowded or in too much shade, but also the actual work. How do you divide thousands of square feet of overzealous perennials or all those many thousands of sulking bulbs? I sometimes think it would be easiest to advertise for people to come take it all away, you know, like kittens, free to a good home, and start from zero. But of course, there is no shortcut through to our next stage of life, the gardens and mine, except to dig in and do it, to stay put even when it hurts. But wait, look, there's another chance to defer and delay. The grass needs cutting again. Phew. I came to this latest writing assignment and this latest year of gardening feeling grateful and panicky, and then the plot sickened. Would it surprise anyone to know that the heavens didn't hear my plea to help me craft a dynamic narrative by delivering a dramatic year, but one with only happy endings? That winter stayed too long? followed by the spring into summer of pounding rains and hail, which amounted to the best weather anywhere in a nation otherwise violently flooding or baking without relent. That the one week it stopped raining, a postcard arrived from the power company saying they'd be on this dirt road soon to do their every 10-year pruning, and that the results were not what I'd seen in any pruning manual, and worse, they dropped limbs from the giant native roadside trees so carelessly that things in the garden below got crushed, yielding needless extra casualties. That the smartest team of woodchucks I have ever played chess with took up residence, along with three battalions of chipmunks who carved tunnels with openings just big enough to lose a foot in, and I did, repeatedly. That following a nighttime hunting injury, Jack the demon cat, a stray who was for 9 previous years my protector, my living rodenticide on 4 legs, and an outdoor cat, ah, the days of no pet hair, would morph into an almost total wuss, signaling to the chipmunks and yet another rodent relative, the rabbits, that all was fair game around here, no guard on duty, enter at will, have at it, guys. That the ample rain would require twice weekly mowing of the grassy parts, a total of 7 hours work every 7 days from late April well into November, and that my favorite mower would give out, the only one I've ever found that I could easily push around the endless curves of this place with all its amoebic sloping beds and borders. That while humping the new, much heavier and less nimble machine, my left shoulder capsule, the tissue around the joint, would give out, or at least get stuck, rendering it painfully frozen with only limited range of motion for months and months. That the driveway would wash away, twice. That a relative of the yellow-bellied sapsucker who killed a precious lacebark pine not so many years ago, this year targeted the most prominent remaining tree in the garden. By systematically drilling into a magnolia that has stood across from my kitchen door since I arrived and planted it, he is well on his way to delivering to it and to a little part of me a very slow unwind. And then, deciding all that was just the pregame show, it really got going, nature did, so that by the time a sixth of the year still remained, we were 14 inches, about 30% ahead of normal precipitation for the year, with most of that delivered in pounding deluges. As I often remind myself and anyone listening, there is the one thing I know with certainty about gardening after 30 years of study and practice. Things will die. But not everything does, which is what keeps those of us who are in the game addicted. And besides, I am getting ahead of the story. You cannot rush a garden or a season, even in its retelling. All of that will unfold in due time in the year portrayed on the pages to come. Let's start at the beginning and see what the elements, those bossy bastards who hold almost all the cards, had in mind for us.
Chapter 1.
The likeness of this present life is as water that we send down out of heaven, and the plants of the earth mingle with it, whereof men and cattle eat, till, when the earth has taken on its glitter and has decked itself fair, and its inhabitants think they have power over it, our command comes upon it by night or day, and we make it stubble, as though yesterday it flourished not. Even so, we distinguish the signs for a people who reflect. The Quran, Surah 10:24, Jonah. Author's footnote, the Quran, AD 610-629, variously uses we, he, and Allah to refer to God. I awaken to gunshots. Have I fallen asleep with the television on again? No, no electronically induced gloaming emanates from across the room. As that fact of darkness registers, so does awareness that it is no longer deer season, meaning that cannot be it either. No one is shooting, not some MI5 character on the TV monitor, risking peril in defense of the realm. Not some local hunter tromping through the woods in the pre-dawn, hoping to fill the freezer, or perhaps just bring home bragging rights with a 6-pointer. It is winter, a very cold night in winter, and the trees are talking back. My aging skin is talking back, too, thirsty for the thick, steamy aftermath of an August sun shower, or even of the fog that settles here on fall mornings as the earth releases warmth it stored all growing season, and with it moisture into a receptive alchemical sky that completes the equation, sending down the lowest kind of cloud. Why hasn't my species adapted better to life indoors in winter, the way many bromeliads shape themselves to their high-in-the-sky, not-rooted-in-the-soil, native treetop homes by forming their leaves in a cup-like arrangement to catch whatever droplets fall, and the occasional yummy insect who turns the collected water to nourishing broth? I absent-mindedly scratch the dry patch on my forearm in the mist of semi-sleep, take a thankfully insect-free sip from the mason jar located by groping in the general vicinity of the nightstand, and try to settle back. Someone fires off a few more rounds. Apparently none of us can get comfortable tonight, not the trees and certainly not one 50-something gardener sequestered like a piece of tinder inside a heated box she calls home in every season, not just in this brittlest one, spent mostly therein confined. In here, or truthfully maybe anywhere, anytime at my age, I cannot take in enough water to plump up all dewy and fresh. I am no garden after a spring rain. I am not spring at all any longer, except in my ever-juicy cache of recollections. Nothing lasts. Just yesterday, I stood before the mirror in the dining room and pulled back my face momentarily as if a too-tight ponytail were doing the pulling, while contemplating mini facelifts, low humidity, and the inexorable ravaging of age. Outside, the native black locusts and maples are feeling not old or parched exactly, but rather overstuffed, too big for their britches, or at least their bark, as sap and other liquids inside them expand beyond capacity. Bang, 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 shoot 'em up, baby. Nobody seems to be at ease right now, a consequence of the watery nature we living things have in common, the trees and me included. It hurts to be too dry or too cold when you are really just one of nature's many intricate vessels, as we all are, far more labyrinthine than the jelly jar beside me, perhaps, but each a mere vessel, just the same. And so I adjust again in the darkness, shifting the duvet and my hoodie and nudging at the men's white cotton sweat socks, the ones I buy in the plastic three packs, urging them upward one after the other with the toe of the opposite foot to please cover any gap where the cold might find me. Then I nestle in to listen to the arboreal artillery. Might as well enjoy the show. There's no fighting back. As another long night evaporates a drop at a time, I find myself thinking in liquid form, like how frogs and their amphibian kin seem most comfortable in their skins in a rainstorm, the bigger the better, when they move about on the hunt with positive celebratory abandon. Slugs and insects, beware. I recall longingly how in the wake of soaking rain, recalcitrant weeds become compliant, agreeing to slip, roots and all, from the ground with just a gentle tug. It's as if they are happy to come away with me and give up their lusty ways, as if it were their pleasure, not mine. I think about days when the sweat socks stay in the drawer and bare feet press, 4 prints apiece, into dew-soaked grass when they step outside first thing, even before tea, to feed the fish and birds out back. The ritual like an ablution with which I baptize each new day, then make their way back home. I contemplate the pull and power of water, the place where all life began, and the only naturally occurring substance found in all three states at earthly temperatures, solid to liquid to gas, until it is time to welcome another dark morning and put the kettle on to boil. As much as I can study up on water, memorizing that it weighs 8.33 pounds per gallon, for instance, or that beneath a depth of 656 feet, almost no light penetrates the ocean, I do not thereby become 1 ounce more capable of convincing this primal element to do as I would like, tonight or any time. None of us can have his or her or its way, at least not now. We must simply try to lay low, each in our own manner, until it's over, not unlike what our analogs in the driest, hottest places must do in their most severe season, in the torpor of estivation. Frozen water, no water, too much water, obstacles all for we who try to live on in spite of something. No wonder we coined the expression in hot water for troubled and uncomfortable times. Ouch. Though they have been unseen since November, I know that aquatic frogs, whose mad splashing and syncopated belching delight me when conditions allow, now lie in a semi-frado hibernation on top of the muck at the bottom of my backyard water gardens. The weeds have mostly likewise made their retreat, but they have posted rhizomes and roots and seeds like sentries on stakeouts so they can recapture territory for each of the invader species the minute conditions are deemed favorable. That will be no time soon. We all have months to go, whatever our intentions. I shouldn't even think such thoughts, though, as they stir the start of a shiver no socks or sweatshirt can insulate against. How much longer, how many more times must we call for the gravel spreader to liberate us or have the oil tank retopped? We must wait because the year ushers itself in at 42.11 degrees north latitude and 73.51 degrees west longitude, the center of my universe and my center of gravity, not all fluid and cooperative and available, but typically quite inhospitably frozen, as if to say, just go away. Many sometime resident songbirds did just that, and other creatures burrowed underground or into a crevice somewhere before the current reality set in rock or trunk or maybe even in my penetrable old foundation and the holy basement it pretends to enclose. Burr, baby, burr. On the most brutal days, sap, soil, and every surface is as solid and cold as ice, or even enclosed in or bursting at the seams with water's winter avatar, since it's not that things like silt or clay or sand or gravel or rocks freeze exactly. It's all about the pores. The water that filled the pore spaces between those particles of soil or between bits of stones large and small and any other void it could find has been transformed to pore ice, taking up more room as a solid than it did in liquid state. Ouch again. Up comes the fence post. There go the heuchera I tucked in a little too late last fall in the bed along the front walkway. Such levitation acts are going on, unsanctioned by me, behind the curtain of snow. I know they are. Ice is the puppeteer. All of us are merely its marionettes, and for my part, I am inclined to lose my footing with regularity when in its not-so-non-skid grip. My bone density scan indicates this is a bad place to be right now. I live on seasonally frozen ground this time of year, like more than half the land in the northern hemisphere, an equation whose main causal factors are temperature and water. But other than in such violent heaving as always befalls my heuchera, or when the wind gets really bossy, or when I dare to try to walk over to the sand and salt bucket to treat the driveway when I should be crawling, we are all, living and non-living things here alike right now, joined in a suspended animation of sorts, or at least on notice not to push it, to take things really, really slow. Trees dare not bend too far. I, too, hear my joints popping in complaint when I climb the stairs each night, or even late afternoon when I've had it with days that go dark at 4 and cannot endure an upright position of attention a moment past 5. We wait, all of us, though some more quietly and uncomplainingly than others. This is my 25th winter in this place, though I suppose I am stretching it a bit to say this piece of land and I have endured 25 winters of each other's company. It's only since the closing days of 2007 that we have lived together nonstop. In that time, I have spent only a single night away to lecture in Princeton, New Jersey in 2011. We are constant companions now, yes. Truthfully, neither of us has anywhere else to go or to be. But you know how that is. Some days are frankly better than others. And some are downright rocky, even when you have paid your dues in time and attentiveness, as we both have, each in our own way. Perhaps the gardens and mine is a long marriage by virtue of the very fact that for most of those years we were long-distance lovers, unable to be together more than weekends and vacations. I had a job, and it fed both of us, keeping us in shovels and seeds. So off I went each Sunday night or Monday morning after another embrace or temporary fusion of a gardener and her garden, each an all-too-brief encounter. I had to support my spendthrift darling, who always had a real Jones for plants that I was happy to indulge. As it goes with all such geographically challenged affairs, though, you reach a moment where either you break up or one of you must relocate, and the garden wouldn't move. That's why I live here today. 25 years. Looking out the window right now, I think how fitting it is that to commence our quarter centennial, nature delivered to us a gleaming tundra, a nonstop silvery winter landscape, a gift wrapping, if not a gift exactly. Its windblown surface is wildly beautiful, if also a bit overwhelming, not unlike the way I feel about the garden beneath the surface when the wrapper melts and he, she gets naked and shows her truer, needier self. Happy silver anniversary, baby. I'm sorry that I always try to push you around and make you do things that don't come naturally. I'm sorry that I am a control freak and a critic, even worse, walking around with my stupid clipboard, muttering about and noting your vulnerable parts that I deem to be in need of cosmetic surgery, look who's talking, but never making similarly bulleted, exclamation-pointed lists of your many assets. Was your life better when you had more privacy and weekdays to yourself? We try to make each other happy, we really do, but sometimes, well, he/she can be a little relentless and demanding, or at least that's my side of the story. I assume I would be accused of being distracted and even neglectful, of spending too much time staring out at the situation or writing my ridiculous to-do lists rather than taking action, of letting her let herself go. Relationships, particularly long ones, take patience and passion both, two words springing from one root, the Latin pati, to suffer, whose past participle is pass, meaning to feel or suffer or endure or submit. Makes you want to ask your doctor to start calling you a client, doesn't it? At least the root of that word only means to listen, follow, obey, which beats suffering. Patience is passion tamed, wrote the late 19th and early 20th century progressive Congregationalist clergyman Lyman Abbott, who also confessed a fondness for flowers but not for dirt, preferring to buy rather than grow his blooms. Smart man. It saves a lot of heartache, laundry soap, strokes of a stiff brush, and time. Winter in particular takes a taming of one's passion and extended patience. Things are locked up tight, and there is no set day marked for the reopening, though for me summer, with its sometimes blazing heat and potential shortage of rain resources, is the most hard-hearted time of all. Deep freeze or no, the garden never closes. Yes, I am upstairs burrowing, though not as productively as the local female black bear, who actually often delivers her young while in hibernation in January or February. My other fair-weather cohabitants are underground or underwater or gone south, but even in an old-fashioned winter such as this one's proving to be, the garden never closes. Each fall, gardening friends can be heard swapping tales of garden cleanup and whatever the year's aberrant weather brought, while also sounding their annual lament. The season's almost over, they say, the level of their voiced despair growing louder as each week passes. Another year gone. Maybe I am just stubborn, not a bad quality to have when you work a steep hillside in USDA Hardiness Zone 5B, but such talk rankles me. I see no evidence that the garden is ever really out of season. Not even today at 19 degrees Fahrenheit with 13 inches of snow on the ground. It doesn't close up shop or shut its doors on me or to visual enjoyment. It never stops teaching either, making its at once spectacular, scientific, and sensual appeals for awareness. The local garden centers may need to stand idle a portion of each year between the last Christmas tree strapped to the car roof for the trip home, fa-la-la-la-la, la-la-la-la, and the first flat of violas or pansies put out for sale just over 3 months later, but not the landscape itself. And so, stubbornly and defiantly all these years, at first accidentally and lately more intentionally, as my knowledge has grown, I suppose I have made a garden for 365 days. Good thing I did, since I now live in it year-round, having left my career, paycheck, and the relentless city for a place where not much else is on the social calendar, but staring out at it, or writing about it, or being outside in it, depending on the time of day and year. Hear my confession. To make a year-round garden was not my plan, or at least not a conscious one I could have explained when I began digging holes on an overgrown, bramble-infested bit of Columbia County, New York land, a steep tract 2+ hours and a world away from Manhattan, where full wheelbarrows fight against maintaining an upright position, and carefully applied mulch relocates great distances downhill at the slightest provocation in the form of a downpour. The spot had little more to recommend it horticulturally beyond a half dozen very old apples, 2 big conifers, and a mismatched trio of ancient lilacs, 2 pale lavender syringa vulgaris, sort of your basic old-time garden variety, and 1 a slightly less typical silvery blue variant. My 365-day garden style was actually a happy side effect, but in this case, my curiosity about birds was the catalyst. Because birds' needs vary at different times of year, I read up and intentionally filled the garden with plants to satisfy them, and in the process, unintentionally surrounded myself with plants that do more than flower momentarily and then just stand there, the way a lilac does, or shudder, a forsythia. I call that ubiquitous yellow upchuck vomit of spring, and prefer to look at it from a distance, like the 2 very large, unpruned old forsythia ex intermedia far beyond my fence line that probably once marked a long-gone farmhouse's drive. The genus Viburnum, for instance, became one of my original collectibles as I sought among its many species a self-serve automat of summer fruit, fall fruit, and even some winter fruit to sustain avian visitors who were raising families, traveling onward, or staying here into the tough times and somehow keeping warm. Fruit comes from pollinated flowers, so in pursuit of fruit, I got the blooms to enjoy in spring, and in some cases good fall foliage too, though that had nothing to do with the reproductive process the way the flowers did. It was from plants like these that I learned that the garden was willing to show off without a day off and also attract the maximum number of birds if only I helped it a little with some strategic decisions. More specifics on how to make a bird-friendly garden are in the sidebar at the end of this chapter. Winter's first major flock of cedar waxwings took on fall's remaining supply of crabapples yesterday, for instance, and I got an even better view when they came to drink at the frog pond this morning, treating the floating de-icer as a pontoon from which to launch maneuvers. Like his accidental mother, Jack is a birdwatcher. He is, for good reason, to protect songbirds, not allowed outdoors during daylight hours unsupervised. But he's content these days to watch the feline Discovery Channel I have long called Cat Network TV through the windows and glass doors pretty much all day, or at least between naps and meals. These crisply painted birds with their crested heads and masked faces home in on off-season fruit in the garden, such as the hollies and the crabapples and the eastern red cedars, Juniperus virginiana, from which the waxwings get part of their name. I have a giant such tree in my front yard, and I can watch them from my bed each morning, which, because the site is so precipitous, is on a level with the top third of the juniper, not something I planted myself or planned. Knowing what I know now about the pleasure of birdwatching in bed, however, I would highly recommend figuring this angle of observation into a garden design. Bed as treehouse? Dreamy. That from inside out anecdote is an example of the other important thing I know about garden design, another insight I got inadvertently as well, simply because I never sit down in the garden long enough to really view it from outdoors. Out there, I am typically doing something, weeding, dragging hoses, mowing, or simply panicking, which takes a lot of time, but is good exercise if you pace or stagger about and wring your hands while in the throes. It's from indoors that most of my garden viewing takes place, including long hours just watching in the cold weather months such as today, a fact that motivated me to make the off-season scenery more inviting with massed winterberry hollies, colorful twig willows and dogwoods, or remarkable conifers, for instance, on various axes from my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.